Welcome. Episode, Dr. James Beckett Sports Card Insights here with Rich Klein. We're going to talk about Thurman Munson. And thanks to Topps, Panini, Upper Deck, Burbank Sports Cards, Mike Stadium Sports Cards, Beckett Media, Beckett Grading, Beckett Authentication, ComC.com, Heritage Auctions, and Huggins and Scott Auctions. I guess every one of the sponsors would have had some connection at some point with Thurman Munson. There are plenty of Thurman Munson cards that are being graded, that are being authenticated. His signature is tough. The ComC's got plenty of stuff there. The card shops, Burbank and Mike's, they're both. But you're a New York, New Jersey guy.
Yes.
And a Yankee guy. So there's more to it than just the guy's cards.
Well, Thurman was the first captain of the Yankee after Lou Gehrig. You know, they would never have another captain. And then with the way Munson was as a player, I believe in 75 or 76, and it was an honor for him to become the first Yankee captain since Lou Gehrig. It's really sad both of them passed so young.
Yeah.
And the way Thurman passed is tragic.
Yeah, yeah.
So is the way Lou Gehrig passed. But Thurman was flying home.
Well, no warning. Yeah.
He was flying home on his off days, and he was learning how to fly more and more. And the plane landed in such a way that the other two people survived and he didn't. And he, from what they've said, is the two people, you know, tried to get him out. He says, no, I'm not going to make it. The two of you get out and survive.
Wow. Well, yeah. Do you think he ought to be in the Hall of Fame?
No.
Really?
No.
He is. Do you think he's not more deserving than Ted Simmons?
Ted Simmons is more deserving. And it pains me to say that, but
listeners, this is unscripted. I am shocked. Rich is the one that suggested Thurman Munson. I'm okay with him being in the Hall of Fame.
I'm okay with
and
it.
And when they put in, Ted Simmons, I thought, I'm just, how does this work? Because I really want to reward excellence. I want sustained excellence, but excellence is more important than longevity.
I think the problem
the
is
year,
he didn't get the tail end of his career to goose up the counting numbers. His numbers quite aren't there. Because he really only has three or four great years. He does. It's like the Roger Maris argument.
Well, no, they goose up his counting numbers, but they goose down his average numbers.
Right.
You know, that he'd get more RBIs, but his batting average would go down. Maybe his power would go down. I mean, he was not 100% physically
power
the last
already,
year.
Cleared, yeah. In fact, in 78, he didn't hit a homer for like 2 months. And then in the playoffs in 1978, in the game, George Brett hits three homers. He hits this monster homer to the left field bleachers at Old Yankee State or Middle Yankee Stadium. Which is a poke. And all of a sudden, that tired body, how he hit the ball 450 feet, I still don't know. But I just don't think he's a Hall of Famer. I think he and Roger Maris are the two Yankees that people always talk about for being in the Hall of Fame that just don't, they're just under the cusp. And I don't think
he's under the cusp for you with respect to regular season play of statistics, but you throw in, like I said, the All-Star games, and the outstanding postseason play that he had in playoffs, that he really rose to the occasion, the captaincy,
the tragic passing, honestly, is important.
I mean, all that stuff, that doesn't put him over the top for you.
No, and it pains me, but it doesn't put him over the top for me. I don't think he's a Hall of Famer. And you know, I want to say something.
He's priced his Hall of Famer.
He's priced his Hall of Famer. In fact, this is going to sound terrible, but the weekend after he passed, I went to a couple of Jersey flea markets with people I know who were selling cards, and I bought every Munson card I could at full price at the time because instinctively I knew how beloved he was and how the market was going to goose up the prices of his cards, right, which it promptly did.
Yes.
And so it was one of these things where, so I know from personal experience when we saw recently with Kobe Bryant's passing,
yes,
why people do that. Some people do that out of greed. Some people do that out of
appreciation,
yeah, and it gooses up the value. I don't do that anymore because I now have enough cards and I'm older and I don't want to do that. What I did at the age of 18 or 19 is not something I would do today. And I appreciate it's a capitalistic society and you can do what you want. But on the other hand, you know, I like what Rob Veras and Mike Fruchtman did to get the cards.
Yes.
Notice your two sponsors who have card shows both worked on getting those cards back to the community, back to people who really would appreciate it.
Right. One of the, there's a lot of great podcasts. You've been on some of them, and I hope we're in those ranks. And we appreciate all the listeners, but like I said, we're not the only game in town. But many of the other podcasts talk about kind of the Hall of Fame bump. And you and I have been around more than most of these to see that it's generally true, but like for Thurman Munson, if he did get in the Hall of Fame from the Veterans Committee, Would there be much of a bump?
There wouldn't be a bump on the 70 card or the 71 card, but there would be a bump on 72 to 79, the last years of his life. I would have always wanted it. It always depressed me that Topps didn't do a card in 1980, an in memoriam card, and get his career stats and do a tribute card. I think that would have helped as well. But his early cards are super popular. The 70 rookie and the 71 Topps condition, the great photo of the player sliding in. And I'll wager, and we're taping this just before we see Topps Heritage, but I'll wager card number 5 in Topps Heritage this year is Gary Sanchez with a horizontal pose. I will wager. And we heard from Clay at the William Card Rip that he says he wouldn't comment, but it was yeah.
Well, that would be a great throwback tribute.
And he's got a 79 Burger King card, and I think there's only a week or two between the time the card got issued and
his pack.
So it's really almost impossible to have a signed card. If you have or two, I'd be shocked.
Last card autographs for situations like that are the tougher ones, not the rookie card.
But what's interesting, and I know they're not a sponsor, but I actually had a couple. I was taking the cards to JSA for a friend of mine. They were doing an appearance, and I think Jimmy was in town, and a couple of balls that had Thurman Munson, because the guy's father-in-law is Danny Cater, who was a Thurman Munson teammate. Right. And they told me that for as tough as Munson was at in-person signing and all that, almost every team ball, the Thurman Munson autograph is good.
Because he
signed in the clubhouse.
He's the ultimate team guy.
He's the ultimate team guy. He always, his 98% of the signatures on team balls of Munson are good.
Okay. If you mentioned this, if I say that his last, a person's last card is his ultimate card, his last card. If I say that his next to last card is his penultimate card, what is the next to last?
The 77 Topps.
Correct answer, but okay, now let's go the other way. Is that the rookie card, he's got a 70 Topps rookie card that he shares with
Dave McDonald. Yeah, okay. Number 189.
Yeah, okay. So he's got a rookie card, and then he has a 71 card. Again, very desirable and condition sensitive. So the aforementioned card number 5, that's his sophomore kind of card. What's his third year card called?
I wouldn't even call
his
it
junior year.
His junior year, but I wouldn't.
But you can't. That doesn't make sense. You can't say it's his tertiary card. What would you say?
I used to use,
because the first 2 or 3 years.
I used to use 71 as first card alone. I used to use that term. It never picked up, but to me, I love that term, because you had that was his first card alone on a card, and like 70 Lou Piniella has the Topps All Star rookie logo. He had a 64 rookie, a 68 rookie, 69 rookie. And then the 70 card
is his first alone card.
And I always thought there was something cool about a first alone card. 72 is cool for Munson because he's got both a regular and an action card. And it's not a high series card, but it's not a super low series card. It's in the 400s, I think, like 443 or somewhere.
443 or something.
Somewhere around there. And those cards are actually kind of neat.
No, but again, my point is that rookie card, everybody knows to chase that. Second year card or the first solo card, That is desirable. But I rarely see very much about the third year card, and there's nothing to call it, I don't think.
And yet,
really early on, these early career cards of the players, it's like, So do you see where I'm going?
I see where you're going. I think it's kind of cool. I'll just call it an early card. I think we're fine with that. And, Munson's got so many cool cards in that 10-year period. And I love I believe it's the 75 or the 76 SSPC where he's got the full beard on the card that he had to shave because Steinbrenner, when he came back. No facial hair.
Any particularly undervalued cards? I mean, I assume you don't recognize anything as an overvalued Thurman Munson card, price guide notwithstanding.
Assuming you are correct and he will make the Hall of Fame someday, I think the 72 to 76 era of his cards are a little undervalued when he makes the Hall of Fame.
Because they're not rookie.
They're not rookie. They're not rough, but they're not tough.
76 is his MVP year.
It's number 650. Okay. And I think those are a little undervalued. And maybe even 77. 78, there's
You mean undervalued in a grading sense or in just a raw sense?
In a raw sense.
And we've had this discussion before, but I'm wondering about some of the other, oddball issues. He's got a lot of discs. He's got a lot of different things like that. But you don't see a lot going on.
You don't see a lot. I believe he's one of the few players. I think he and Jerry Grody are the only two people that appear on more than one 71 Topps Greatest Moment card because they are background shots in Yankee Stadium.
Right.
So
that would be good.
Those 71 Greatest Moment is it's an oversized card. It's a funky shape.
Right. Well, it's a tall boy.
It's a tall boy.
It's a horizontal tall boy.
That would be a card that if I think you really wanted to have significant upward potential in a high grade, that would be the one I would get.
Okay. What about OPG? Because I think he's got OPG rookie, OPG 71.
He's got an OPG every year. He does not miss an OPG.
Well, then they started mirroring the sets after. Right.
Well, 77 is a little weirder because they don't really mirror this. They have all the different poses. Yeah. And there's a lot of value in the OPG Munsons. A lot of value there, too. I think the 70 and the 71 are really good.
Okay. I'm thinking about going to the Toronto show in a couple months. And if I do, what do you think the chances are that I'll find a 70 or 71 OPG Munson, or 72 even?
I think you will. I think you'll have to dig a bit.
At a fair price? At a price that's reflective of the price guide?
Or? I'm not sure, because I haven't been to Toronto since 1997 or 98. I remember the last time I went to Toronto when I was working for y'all, is that, you know, I was partially a hockey guy at that, but mostly a baseball guy. And when I walked around as the baseball guy, people were pointing me, oh, go see this person for this card and go see this person for these cards. And we came up with so much stuff for the Almanac just by people saying, oh, I got stuff for the Almanac for you. I might have actually gone over the $400 limit and had somebody else bring back some cards so I could be under $400.
There's Yankee fans up in Toronto. I mean, it's still, you know, baseball is probably number two behind hockey for the collectibles there. And they would have stuff there.
But, I think it's about 85-90% hockey, about 10-15% baseball on the Toronto show.
Yeah.
But I enjoyed the Toronto show. I loved going there. It was a lot of fun, I think. And I think you can travel a little more now. I think there's several shows you haven't been to for a long time that you'll have a really good time at.
Okay. Would you be similar to me in the sense that when I'm at a show, I'm not, as I mentioned a few episodes ago, I'm not that focused. So I'm looking through a box. If there's something, Thurman Munson wasn't my favorite player or anything, but I respected him. And so if I saw a Thurman Munson that I think looked interesting, you know, I'd probably pick it up.
I'm like you. If I'm looking at a random box and I think the value's there, I'll just buy the card without knowing, you know, that I'm specifically going. You and I, a lot of times, are doing the same thing. We're going through the dime box, the quarter box, the 50-cent box, the dollar box. You know, I focus a little differently than you do in some extent, because I'll look a little more at, we'll call it older stuff or, you know, stuff that I know. But you and I can go through dime boxes and quarter boxes from the same deal at the same show. We won't have a lot of overlap.
Well, again, we're diverging a little bit from the Thurman Munson discussion, but let's bring it back this way. And that is that when I'm looking, it sounds like, and I've seen your stuff, you focus pretty much on recognizable players.
Yes.
And I don't. I actually don't have any problem buying something that is not a very recognizable player if it's an interesting card, because it's when we did our type collecting. And so we're almost out of time. My last question for you, Rich, is how recognizable to the new collector is Thurman Munson? He's been gone for 40 years. And so when you're at your show, if there's a Thurman Munson in there in one of your 25-cent cards, and it could be a great deal, wouldn't it get passed over?
Probably.
Because he's not in the Hall of Fame, even though I think you could make a case for it. He's borderline. I'm not saying that, but that he's absolutely deserving. But he's an MVP. I put a lot of stock in somebody that won an MVP.
I'll throw it out. If I had, and I know they weren't quite as good as Munson, but a Rocky Colavito or a Norm Cash in those boxes, a lot of people would pass on them too, because they just wouldn't remember.
They just wouldn't recognize, because they're. And, well, you know, we could do those on another day, because both those guys had amazing runs of excellence, not just being a good player, but being a great player for a while. Time's up. Thanks, listeners. Thanks, Rich. We'll be back again tomorrow with another episode. Might not be with Rich, but Rich is my regular or semi-regular participant here in our conversations, and I enjoy it, and I hope you enjoy it as well. And, Rich,
thanks for having me, Jim.
We'll be back again tomorrow.